Good morning, Jubilee. If you guys would like to stand, find somewhere where you got enough space to worship, dance.
Can't contain the overflow. There's a fire that's burning in my all my desire. Thank you. safe in surrender.
To you.
strong on my own. I don't want to weep without you. Don't want to be weak on my own. I don't want to run without you. Don't want to be strong on my own. I don't want to weep without you. Don't want to be weak on my own. Oh, don't want to be weak on my own. Oh, don't want to be weak on my own. down my life, giving up control, never looking back. I surrender all, I'm living for your glory on the earth. This passion in my heart, the stirring in my soul, the nations bow for all the world to know, and I'm living for your glory on the earth. For the sake of the world, like a fire in me, light a flame in my soul for every eye to see. Like a fire in me, fire in me, light Oh,
Yes, Lord. For the sake of the world, burn like a fire in me today, God. For the sake of the world, for the sake of other people, God, would you burn like a fire in our hearts, God? In Jesus' name, will you set us on fire today, God? Set us on fire for the world. God, will you do what it is that you want to do in us today, God, in order that other people would be changed, in order that other people would experience the love of God, in order that other people would hear the gospel, in order that other people would be healed. God, we thank you, God, that you are calling up a people to rise. You're calling a people to rise, a people of fire, a people of grace, a people of the miraculous, a people of healing. Everyone say this, say, I am one of those people. God's setting me on fire, and he's sending me out to change the world. Today's the day that I'm being changed, that I'm being commissioned, that I'm being set on fire. My workplace will never be the same again. My college will never be the same again if you're in college. There's a transformation happening in this place today. It is a transformation of fire. You know, it says that the Lord has eyes of burning fire. And you know that when you look at him, Jonathan David Helser said this, he said, I've seen I am, and now I know just who I am. And you know, there's something about just gazing into the blazing eyes of fire that's bringing a transformation from the inside out today. And for some of us, we get a little bit complacent. We're like, wow, yeah, that was nice. It was good worship today, but I'm kind of hungry. But I want to encourage you today, there is a stirring. There's an impartation of a gift of hunger in this place. There's a gift of hunger being released in this place. Hunger for the things of the gospel, hunger for the things of the fire of God, that we would be transitioned and move into bringing a breakthrough into areas that need breakthrough. We are region changers. We are nation changers. We are world changers. In Christ, everything is possible. And I just want to encourage you, there's a breakthrough and a release of the miraculous for you today. Whatever it is that you need, God is in this place to perform the miraculous for you, and then you will perform the miraculous with God for other people. And so if you receive that, just say yes and amen to that. Just say amen. Just say, I receive that. I receive that. Say, I'm a world changer. And that's the truth. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Awesome. God is so good. Isn't God good? Let's just give him a shout of praise in this place. No, let's give him a shout of praise. A shout of praise in this place. You are worthy. You are good. You are holy, you are worthy. There's no competition with the rocks in Bondo. They won't need to cry out today. God is so good. Amen and amen. So good. It's so good to have you at Jubilee this morning. Welcome. Just as you find your seats in a second, just give someone a hug and say, you are a man or a woman of fire. You can find a seat.
Jordy and the team. Wow. We don't need the heating on in here. It's now so hot, so much fire. Welcome back from Peru. Look forward to the testimonies. Fin and Izzy send their love. They're ministering down at Hope City, down in Melbourne, and it's going well down there already. They're seeing, even last night, just break out of dance spontaneously at the end there, and so we look forward to them coming back testifying what's happening down there. So pray for them today as they're ministering to the two services. I think they've got a morning and an evening, and then they'll be back here in Sydney tomorrow, I think. Very good. So welcome to Jubilee. If this is your first time visiting, an extra special welcome to you. And just to let you know, and this is for everyone who sometimes if you bring visitors along, we've previously had our visitors lounge in the cafe area, but with all the changes that have been happening with the kids and registration, we've now shifted it up a little bit. So you'll find the visitors lounge. So if you've got a visitor with you, or you are yourself a visitor, please, after the service, just make your way into this space to my left, your right, and you can meet today Roger and Louise. And Louise, when she brings the food, that's when you want to be in visitors lounge. She's a very, very good cook, so please go and make yourself known to the team when you go through there. We'll just take up the offering. The team's ready to go. Thanks, Cheryl. Just to let you know, I think Finney touched on it last week, the building fund's now up to $360,000. Not bad, hey? Bearing interest until we can, you know, the timing of the Lord is everything. You can continue to sow into that if you want to write it on the slips. We're still sowing into that for the right timing to put in an offer to buy this building. So we're very excited. Now, Create School, this week is the final week of term. So it's Izzy's doing part 3 of Wisdom. So you don't want to miss that at 5:30. And just to let you know, we have the MP4s. Woohoo! So if you missed any of term 1, or you missed the whole lot of term 1, you can now get it for $50. You can get the MP4. So today, normally the book table's open from 10:30 till 11. But Leslie, who I just roped in at the last minute, thank you, Leslie, is just going to be up the back. If you want to get a hold of the MP4, which is the whole of term 1, for $50. So that's like 9 or 10 sessions, hours and hours worth of teaching that you don't want to miss. So well worth the purchase. So go after the service and she'll be up the back there to sell that to you. And just next term, just to give you a heads up, we've also, when we kick off Create, I think it's mid-August, we'll give you more details. Jonathan Welton is going to be with us. Yoo-hoo! So just Google him, because he's, yeah, a mighty man of God. Prophet, seer, teacher, very, very exciting time. We'll give you more details of his arrival. You're not going to want to miss that week. And this week, obviously, Harp and Bowl, Wednesday, 7:30, so don't forget that. Our prayer and worship night. Because there is something on here on Friday night, Nightlife will be meeting the following week. So if you're a young adult and usually come to the Nightlife young adults events, just hold off until next week. So 7:30. So 7:30 next Friday for all you young adults. Kids. Kids. So parents, if you want to take your kids through for the new system of registration, it's going to get quicker and quicker now that, you know, every kid's being registered in, so the names of the kids will be down there, be easy to sign them in and out. But if parents, you want to quickly take your kids through to Kids Church, have fun, kids. Awesome. And thank you, everyone who's just been, yeah, just transitioning into that whole new system. You guys have been amazing at just going with the flow. And, so we just want to thank you for honouring the new system. It's been great. Now, we're very excited to have Daryl back from Peru to bring the word today. Let's welcome Daryl.
Come on. So good to be back. Thank you for all your prayers and support. It was an incredible time. We had a wonderful time. I'm going to share some testimonies with you this morning. Pray for some people. How many people are in the 9 o'clock show me? Okay. Oh, okay. A few. Awesome. I'm going to share a similar story, but there's nothing wrong with hearing something twice. Hey, Roger. Awesome. So good. Many of you, how many first time, is it, maybe you don't want to put your hand up. Let's just do it anyway. Any first time visitors here? Just give me a small wave if you've never been here. Welcome. You guys are so welcome. We really want to just honor those. Let's just honor those guys for coming for the first time. It's awesome. Welcome. It's so good. It's so good to have you. Yes, yes, yes. God is going to set some people on fire today. Seriously on fire. Very, very cool. We just came back from doing a two-day camp in, where were we? Foster in New South Wales. It was really awesome. We had a really good time at Liberty Family Church, Geordie, Gabby. We had some of the guys up with us and it was just an incredible time. People were really, really hungry. I was incredibly jet-lagged, but it was still a great time. Amen? So good. Amen. Awesome. Well, okay, I want to kind of mix. I'm going to mix a message to a bunch of testimonies today. And so if you can just put up Barb's up there. Barb, you are amazing. Just put up it. I'm not going to go too deep into too many scriptures, probably two. But Ephesians 2, verse 10, let's stick that up there. If you can, Barb, you're amazing. I'm reading from the New American Standard Bible, and I'm just going to go on ahead, and she will pull up whatever version she decides. But it says this in Ephesians 2:10, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we should walk in them." Which God prepared beforehand so that we should walk in them. I want to start by telling you a story. I went to, as many of you will know, some of you don't know if you're a visitor here today. I've just got back a few days ago from doing crusades in Peru. This is the second year running that I've been doing crusades. And just to give you an idea as to what happens on a crusade is basically about 6 months ago, maybe between 6 and 9 months ago, I was in communication with a number of people that wanted to do some crusades, some miracle evangelism in Peru. So what happens is that there is a ministry coordinator who works for a ministry called Global Evangelistic Missions, and they're based in Peru. And the coordinators, who are all Peruvians, they say, okay, which areas are you feeling like you would like to do crusades in? Then the people that are paying for the crusades say, we would like to do some in maybe this city or that city. And then the coordinators get to work. And it takes about between 6 and 9 months. And they go to the locations and they begin to work with the local churches in those regions to be able to put on big events. And so we, on this trip, we were blessed, privileged to go to two major cities. The first one is Lima. I'm sure most people have heard of Lima. It's the capital city of Peru. And the second one was called Arequipa. And Arequipa is the second largest city in Peru. And so we were very, very blessed to be working with some real incredible coordinators, but also with over 20 pastors from local churches. So what that means is when you do a crusade and these people come forward, and I'm going to give you testimonies and explain how it works, but when people come forward and they say a prayer and they make a commitment to the Lord, what happens then is their details are not just taken, but they're connected immediately to one of the local churches. And so it's not just, okay, you're going to receive Christ and we'll see you next year. It's not like that. And because how many of you know that local church is really, really important? It's very, very important. This trip was an extremely special trip. I want to share with you a testimony, not of a healing or a salvation first, but of something that happened to me when I was in a hotel room when I was there. So just before the Crusades had started and I was staying in Lima and I was sharing a room with one of the evangelists, I stood up in between the two beds And I was taken out of my body. And you'll know in the book of Corinthians, Paul says, he says, I had an encounter, I was taken up to the third heaven, whether in the body or out of the body, I don't know. So it's biblical. And I was taken out of my body, and I was taken into a room where I looked at a TV screen. And as I looked at the TV screen, I saw an image of me standing in that hotel room between the two beds. And I was like, wow, this is really cool. And as I looked, I suddenly realized where I was and what time I was in. Let me tell you what time I was in. I really believe that I was taken back to before I was born. And I was watching a TV screen of something that I was going to do when I was on earth. Now, the realm of the spirit is more real than the realm of the natural. It's more real. How do we know that? Because the realm of the natural is temporary, but the realm of the spirit is eternal. It says that temporary things will pass away. Some of us, well, all of us, our physical bodies in a long time won't be here anymore, but your spirit will be, because your spirit is eternal. And in the scripture that I just put up there, it says that there are good works which God has prepared beforehand for us to walk in them. And in the book of Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5, it says this. It says, Jeremiah, before you were in the womb, I knew you and I set you apart as a prophet to the nations. When was that done? Before he was in the womb. Does that mean that there was something that Jeremiah was called to do before he was even born? Exactly. So I'm in this room in heaven and I'm looking at this video screen and suddenly I know that I know that I know that me standing in that room in between the two beds about to go on the crusades and about to go and do some crazy stuff, and I'm going to give you a couple of testimonies, I knew that I was exactly slap bang in the center of God's will for my life. I knew that I was exactly in the divine destiny that God had always foreknew that I would walk in before I came to earth. It's a very good feeling. And it's not just a feeling, it actually, for me, in the midst of some of the things that we had to walk through when we were there, actually provided a foundation that I knew that I was safe. I knew that it was going to be okay, and we knew that it was going to be an incredible time. So it's good, right?
Yes.
Awesome. We go to Lima, we hang out in Lima, first of all, because we get to sow in, and if you're a part of Jubilee, just to let you know, you sowed in financially to these crusades. Part of your finance went to the sowing in of these of seeing these crusades happen. How many of you know that crusades might, or evening night rallies in the center of a city like Lima could cost something? Okay, so however much you think it costs, probably quadruple it. And that would be probably roughly about what it costs. It's a very mammoth task, and that's why it takes up to 9 months to set these things up. Now, on this second night of the crusade, I was able to do on each of the crusade nights. We were all on the platform, but I was able to do the second night, actually run the second night of each crusade. And I want to take you to the second night of the first lot of crusades in Lima. And I stood on the platform, and before I started to minister, that night I gave my testimony and then did some words of knowledge, and we called some people up, and we saw incredible miracles happen. But I stood on the platform, and they had a little 7-year-old girl come up onto the platform, and she sang the song Oceans by Hillsong in Spanish before we started. Now, I've seen some amazing things in my time. I have, and we all have, but there are some things that get so seared into your heart that you will never forget them for the rest of your life. And that moment, I will never forget for the rest of my life. I stood at the back of the platform, and I got on my knees. And as I got on my knees, and this is on camera, it's on film, and it's on my Facebook page, a glory cloud came over the girl of snow and started to snow over her and then go into the crowd, snowing orbs, snowing angelic orbs over her. You can watch it, it's on Facebook. So I'm in an experience. I'm on my knees. And you know what went through my head? When I'm sitting there, what went through my head was this. All of the atmosphere in the central, in that region of Lima was being changed by her song. All of the atmosphere was being changed by her song. And there was a stillness and a glory. It says that he will quiet you, quieten you with his love. There was a stillness that came over the whole center of the region as she sang, her voice, 7-year-old, echoing out over through the buildings. And there was just a hush over the whole city center. And I was on my knees, and all I could think was Jubilee and me sowed financially into seeing this moment happen for this region. And that was probably one of the highlights of the trip, because I realized that changing regions is and changing nations is what we're called to do. And that there are different ways that we can partner into doing that. But that God wants to give us, I feel like he wants to really commend us for say what we do here at Jubilee, what we do here and hang out in local church is so much bigger than you could possibly imagine. You know, it might sound like one person goes out or another person or someone goes and does something, but it's so much bigger than that. It's a collective of the ecclesia, of the church, the local church of Australia, touching the nations of the earth. And it's our collective prayers and it's our collective financial giving and all of these things, which is actually bringing breakthrough to many nations. So let me tell you what happens. So she changes the atmosphere. Well, what do you think happens after the atmosphere gets changed in that place? Many, many people get saved. There's an open heaven as a result of the song. And people start to get miraculously healed. The altar calls were huge. And the people that were getting saved weren't people that had never been saved before. When people came to the altar, they were weeping as they got to meet God for the first time. It was very, very strongly put that if you've ever said this prayer before, you don't need to come forward. If you've ever made Jesus Christ Lord and Savior of your life, you do not need to be at the altar call. And I'm not saying that every single person, but you need to know that when people were meeting with God, they were meeting with him for the first time. And watching the harvesting angels come, stand beside the stage, and then get loosed out to bring in the harvest was one of the most incredible scenes in the spirit I've ever seen. It's just remarkable. And so as I'm doing that, as I'm standing there, I'm watching like an eternal clock, a reward system. And I'm like, oh my goodness. And he said, and then the father said this, do you know how much treasure is stored up from this process for you? And he wasn't talking about me. He was talking about anyone that was sowing into that particular thing. So I want to encourage you, one day, in many years, you're going to go to heaven and you'll sit on a particular seat in your mansion, and it'll be very nicely embroidered. And the Lord will say, you know that seat? And you'll be like, yeah. And he's like, that was when you prayed for that crusade in Lima. I'm being funny. And you're like, is that biblical? Is that, I don't know. I just like that. I thought it was really cool. All of that to say, you are weighing up for yourselves treasure in heaven. That's what I'm trying to say. Is that okay? Is everyone okay this morning? Okay. One of the things that, and I'm not coming back as a missionary, coming back from overseas and going, you really need fire right now. You know, I don't receive that at all. But let me tell you something about the hunger of people in Peru. Let me tell you about the hunger. The hunger is insane. It made me feel not saved. You think I'm joking? When I went into the churches and I said, oh, and I start going to the churches and I'm preaching. And then the pastor gets up and he goes, we're going to pray for you right now. Well, I can tell you right now, I didn't get up for 45 minutes. And I said, what is this? And they said, oh, they pray from 4:30 every morning. 4:30 in the morning, 2 hours of intercessory prayer. The angels that work with them, ridiculous. The hunger is insane. And I want to commend everybody for being hungry for the Lord. I really feel like this church is so hungry for the Lord. But I felt like the Lord say that there is an impartation coming. There is an impartation here that's bringing hunger up to a new level. It's bringing breakthrough up to a new level. Because God, we're in a season right now that God is bringing us into new experiences of the destiny that we were called for, of the destiny that you were called for as an individual in Christ. I'm really excited. Okay, let me tell you another testimony. So I give my testimony, and hearing your voice echoed out in front of a whole city center with thousands of people doesn't feel as good as you think it might feel. Even though you like your voice, when it's echoed out like that, it's like, hello, 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 hello. My name's Daryl. Daryl, Daryl. And I'm like, I sound like a complete idiot right now. But they can't understand anyway. So I give my testimony the night, and then God says, I want you to move into words of knowledge. And so I start doing words of knowledge, and they're really, really specific. So when there's a problem, like a lump in a left breast or a deaf ear, it's not just the condition, but it's the number of people that have it in the masses. And every time, the exact number of people came out. And every time, the Lord said, you cannot move on until the exact number of people for that condition have come out. Every time a person came out, whether it was for, on the second night, whether it was for problems with backs and knees. Now, I know you go, oh, that's such an easy word of knowledge to get. Well, I had a vision where I saw a door open in heaven, and I saw spines coming down. And you can imagine how many people needed a new spine in those crowds. Then they all come forward, and they're on the platform, as many as we could have, and they're saying, I have now received a new spine, over and over and over and over. It's awesome. It's awesome. So good. Then we have other ladies and other people moving their knees and saying, I couldn't do this before. I've been healed. And then we have six deaf people lined up at the front, every one of them receiving their hearing, one after another. Bang, 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 bang. Prayed for one lady, and she was standing in front of her, and the Lord said, just ask her friend to whisper into her ear. Her friend whispered into her ear, and the tears just started to come down her face. She said, I haven't been able to hear out of that ear for a year. Popped open. I'm just so some of you are like, wow, that sounds awesome. That's God. That's our God. He confirms his word by signs following. And it was an absolute privilege to watch that. And then you come back to Australia and or wherever in the West. You go, okay, you're going to receive healing now in the name of Jesus. I remember one time there was a person come up and I said, you are going to receive your hearing now in Jesus' name. And he said, what was that, Sonny? But today, there are people in here, you're going to get healed today. There's healing in this place today. There's fire in this place today. But I feel like God wants to put something in as well. And I just, this is the thing I feel like God wants to put in. It's this. There are things that you are called to do. And I gave the example of Marilyn Hickey in the last service. But last year, Marilyn Hickey, or this beginning of this year, she was out in Pakistan at 80 years old doing healing crusades at 80. She got saved at 50. And she got aligned to her destiny. And at 80, she's doing the crusades, is she not? Yeah, she's amazing, right? What I want to encourage you in is this. There are things which you are designed to do, which God is now bringing for some people, actually aligning them into even more now than ever before. And it doesn't matter if you're young. Jeremiah was about 12. It doesn't matter if you're old. Moses and what did Joshua say when he was 80? Give me the hill country. It doesn't matter how old you are. It doesn't matter about your physical health right now, because God's going to heal that too. It doesn't matter about your financial limitations, because God's bigger than that. See, we are the children of God, and whatever God decides, that's what's going to happen. And all we need to do is partner with God and say yes and amen. Do it, whatever it is that you want to do in me, so that you can do what you want to do through me, Lord. And that's the only prayer you need to pray, but you need to mean it. Because we're in a position where God wants to encourage you, that some of you prayed a prayer many years ago, and the Lord says that you submitted yourself into a process, and he hasn't forgotten. You submitted yourself into a process of preparation that the Lord hasn't forgotten. And you're going to come up into a place where you start to walk out the very things that you felt like you were called to walk out. For some of you, it could be anything. I'm not saying, you understand, it's not about speaking in front of thousands or anything like that. It might be that you really wanted to be a teacher. It might be that you felt like you were going to be a successful author, talking to people about the things of God. It was those God dreams which were already set in your heart, your God desires, and he says, it is a time, we're in a season of alignment. But you know, it's like, without the process, I really felt 12 years ago, I really felt like I was supposed to go and do crusades. And I said to everyone, I remember going to the flight center and saying, okay, I'm going to book my flights. And I did a flight to Canada, India, everything else. And I booked all these flights. And I said, okay, I'm ready. And God said, what are you doing? And I said, I'm ready. You said that I'm going to go and do crusades. And he said, you haven't entered the process yet. And so then for 8 years, I entered a process where I didn't get to go on a missions trip. I didn't get to go overseas. But God, I'm called to South America. I knew that I was called into South America. And if any of you have known me for any more than 10 years or 5 years or whatever, I'm always talking about it. Why? Because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And so I'm processing and going, yes, I'm called to this. This is what's going to happen. I'm going to be a crusade evangelist. Well, who's hearing me say that? My friends are. Me, I'm hearing me say it. And so what am I doing? I'm starting to frame up a world that starts to look like something. My faith is coming up. There are opportunities. I start to see people doing particular things and going, wow, is it time? Can I ring this person? No, it's not time. Can I ring this person? No, it's not time. Well, after 8 years, I felt the Lord say, it's time, ring this person. And the doors flung open. The first time I went on an international trip for crusades, they gave me a platform on a crusade on my first ever trip. Why? Because I'd waited. I'd let God prepare me. And it's the preparation that you need to be able to carry what you need to carry in order to see breakthrough. We went to a place called Arequipa, and Arequipa has never, ever had anything like what we've released come in there. And let me tell you about Arequipa. Arequipa is an ancient Inca zone. If you know what the Incas are, it was a place of human sacrifice. How many of you know that when you go to a place that's never been touched properly with the gospel before, and you're a carrier of light, how many of you know that you may not be overly welcome in that place initially by some of the things which have been existing there? I'd see dark figures walk through the hotel room in the evening. I'm serious. Shadow people just walk through. I'm like, Shakarambabasete. Wow. It was intense. How many dreams do you think we had? Every team member, they don't like us here. But you know what? The more dreams and the more intense the warfare, the more we knew that the breakthrough was going to be so significant. And so as a team, we stood and we rallied and we contended, and I emailed and you guys prayed, and we saw the most incredible harvest in Arequipa. The first harvest of its kind that they'd ever seen, ever. The pastors who had been there for years said, this has never happened in Arequipa before. They've never heard the gospel like this before. We've never had anyone come in and talk about it like this. Now, there are churches there, but I'm talking about a manifestation of the kingdom in power and bringing people for the first time, allowing them, giving them an opportunity in mass to receive the gospel. It's never happened before. But I can tell you this, if I had gone to Arequipa 5 years ago, Fini might be flying over there to bring me back. Why? Because it was the preparation that got me strong in spirit. So when I was there and when people needed prayer, I didn't say, oh, you know, I can't pray. But I knew how to pray, not because I'm so amazing, but because God had already trained me in what it looks like to do some push-ups with someone standing on my back. I already knew those feelings. I felt that before. It feels like witchcraft. I know how to deal with that. Hold on a second. Loose. I don't receive that in Jesus' name. Because I was carrying something that I learned through the process before I got released. And I want to encourage you that if your calling is big and there is people here and you're like, my destiny's big in God. You're like, yes, Got a big destiny. Well, I'm telling you right now, you need to be a big person to fulfill a big destiny. Why? Because you have to carry it. Remember, I love what Bill Johnson says. He says, if God gave you the ability to cure every cancer right now, it would kill you. How many of you could handle it? No one here. Pastor, pray for me. Please pray for me. My wife needs you. Can you pray for me, please? Can you pray for me, please? What happened to John G. Lake's wife? She died of malnutrition because she was feeding the masses that camped outside his house to be healed. God wants to prepare you for the incredible destiny that he's got for you. And this is a time where he's saying, and I said this earlier, he who dares wins in the kingdom. He who dares wins. Daring is just like risk, R-I-S-K. John Wimber says, the risk is faith. Faith is spelled R-I-S-K. And I feel like the Lord's saying, do you dare risk now to believe that I've got something big, that I've got something special? And big is relative, so don't think, yeah, you know what I'm saying. I'm just saying, in line, do you dare to believe that I'm poised to align you up, to connect you to the things, the good works that I've prepared beforehand for you to walk in? You know, it's a real delight to be standing here and doing things as we do. But in the midst of it, I feel like I'm carrying right now such a hunger for fulfillment of destiny. Not because I really enjoy seeing people walking in the fullness of what they're called to. I love that. But because I know who's on the other side of your destiny, and I love them more. It's true. Whatever it is that God has designed you to do, it's primary focus, its primary purpose is that many would receive the love of God and the reality of the gospel through your life. That's the truth. You were designed to love, and you were designed to transform lives, transform nations, transform regions. We're world changers in Christ. Make disciples of all nations. Yeah, but I'm kind of doing that right now, but kind of, I just want to encourage you. I feel like God is saying that it's the comfort zones are transitioning right now, because to walk into and receive and move into the fullness requires sacrifice. And you know, one of the guys that I was out with, I'm not going to drop any names, but I'm out with this guy. And do you know what he did for the first 5 years of his ministry? Fasted sleep. That was what God told him to do. Fast sleep. And he would pray and fast sleep. And do you know what his wife would say? Please don't pray tonight. Please don't fast sleep tonight. Do you know why? Because when he prayed, when he was fasting sleep, the house would shake so violently that she couldn't sleep. They reported earthquakes in the area. Because when he prayed, the house would shake. And I spent time with both of them. 100% true story. She would beg him, please don't pray tonight, because we need to sleep. They had young children. But when he prayed, the ground would rumble. What's going to start to happen to your zone when you do the thing that God's calling you to do? God is going to do some serious stuff, because we're in an hour right now. We just did a camp called the Daybreakers. We're in an hour right now of the sons of God rising. The sons are rising. And you're like, well, what does that mean? I'll tell you what it means. It means that you are about to fulfill your full potential in God. That's what it means. And let me say this. When I was out, one of the guys was saying this to me. He said, never forget that one day you will have to give account to God for what you did. And I was like, yeah, no worries at all. And then I realized, and I thought, what will I say? And I'm not going into some weird theology or anything. I'm just saying, there is a call and a gift that we are given, and we have been given the opportunity to steward both. How did you steward that desire? How did you steward that gift? And I feel like God is saying that he is alleviating fear so people can steward the gift and call at a new level. He's alleviating fear so you can steward the gift and call at the new level. You know, 8 years ago, God said to me, I had an image of a mountain, and I saw the top of a mountain, and I knew that the top of a mountain was my place, my calling in God. And I said, God, it's so far. How long is it going to take me to get up to the top of that mountain? And I saw a door at the bottom of the mountain. I said, God, I know there's a shortcut. I know there's something I can do to call in the promise before it's time. And he said, it's a process. And he said, but the process will be painful. And I said, oh, God, anything. Just give it to me. I'm so hungry. And it was painful. And I cried. And I had nothing. And it was hard. And I sacrificed everything. And I gave it up over and over and over again. And you know, I went out on the aeroplane on the Qantas flight this time. And I was over there. And I looked around and I was like, and this is not about how amazing I am, by the way. This is how amazing God is. But I was looked around and I was like, I'm the youngest person here. And he said, well done. I'm running with giants and I'm the youngest person here, 36. Pushing the Crusades on the platform at 36. And I know other people have done that from the States. I'm not trying to say that. But I know that I had agreed with things, with the church, with Fin and Izzy, submitting myself into processes of apostolic fathering, saying yes when I didn't want to say yes sometimes, doing the things and submitting my life into a fathering process that allowed a quickening to come on, something in my life that allowed me to propel into something. And I don't know if it's before its time, because it says everything is made appropriate by God in its time. But what I do know is this: there are many mornings and many afternoons and many evenings that I could have chosen something else. Many. But it was a desire to see people, to see lives transformed, that keeps driving us. And I want to encourage you right now. I feel like God's going to give people glimpses of destiny today. I feel like he's going to do destiny glimpses. And you know, when you get a destiny glimpse, you can never unsee that thing, because that thing is joined to something that was put in your heart before you were even born. It consumes you. It's the zeal of the Lord. It's the zeal of the Lord which holds together the desires of your heart. So you can't connect to the desires of your heart without being consumed by the zeal of the Lord. And that's what God's doing in this place. He wants to connect you with the more. And you're like, well, I'm doing everything I can. I haven't got any more time. That's awesome. I'm not trying to make anyone do anything different. But what I am saying is this. What would it look like, and what does it look like to say some radical prayers? Because radical prayers will give radical answers. I'm serious. And there are some people here, and I said this in the last service, there are some people here, and you are called to developing nations. You're supposed to be going. You are. I'm not being a missionary, come back and, yes, we really need to all get to Africa. That's not my heart at all. My heart is just to connect people with the purpose. And there are some people in here, and you know that you were supposed to be sowing finance into Cambodia. I'm serious. That is part of your calling. And God's saying, are you ready to have that part reawakened again? For some people, it's about something else. For some people, it's writing a book. It doesn't matter what it is. I'm just saying that God is ready and waiting to realign, to reawaken that area so you can step into that even more. He takes so much pleasure in us connecting with the thing that we're designed and called to do. There are specific things that you're calling and gifting. There are things that you are only you can fulfill. Only you. How do you know that? They just are. Only you. And God's saying, are you ready for alignment? Doesn't matter how old, doesn't matter how young. God's saying, get ready. You can feel that now. It's coming. Ooh. Get ready for your alignment. It's going to be exciting. And you know, the local church, and I'm going to end on this, the local church apostolic mothers and fathers, mentoring, all of those things are absolutely key to you walking out or experiencing the fullness, the abundant life that Jesus died for you. Absolutely key. And we get into a zone sometimes where we complain and where you get complacent or you get offended or you think to yourself, you get a bit funny and you go, oh, I wish that person did this and I wish that person did that. I felt like God say that it requires a heart of honor. And it's in a place of honor. It says the hearts of the fathers are turned to the sons and the sons are turned to the fathers. Your heart can't be turned to a father unless you honor them. You can't. And it's the fathers honoring the sons and the sons honoring the fathers, which is bringing us into a place where we're experiencing a double portion blessing. And it's the double portion blessing that's actually allowing us, this generation, to rise and to go and to change the nations for God. And the thing is this, this is a great house right here. Jubilee's an amazing place. But this is it. It's all about how much you want. It's all about hunger. It's all about hunger. We had an experience when we were overseas, and we were at one of the crusades, and I'm going to end because I said I'm going to end. Thank you. But we were at a crusade, and one of the main evangelists said this. He said, and he's getting a little bit older, and he said, I am now getting older, and he's been doing they've been doing crusades a long time, seen over 1 million souls, working with like serious stuff, and. He stands on the stage and says, there are people here tonight who are called to preach the gospel and become crusade evangelists. This is what he says. So we're up there. And he said, it's a season where the hearts are turning to the fathers and the fathers are turning to the sons. And he said, and I want to release my mantle. I release a mantle for soul winning in this place today. If you are between the ages, and he gave a particular age bracket, and then he said, and anyone else, if you are hungry to do that, you come forward. Now, not everyone came forward, so don't hear what I'm not saying. But when people came forward, I felt unsaved again. I'm being funny, but I'm not. Because the hunger in the people was insane. The mothers coming forward, older women coming forward and standing on the platform receiving the baptism in fire for evangelism was off the charts. And I was like, oh God, they just want to change the world. And I want to encourage you, and this isn't a rebuke today, this is an encouragement. I want to encourage you that God is saying, are you ready to change the world with me? Are you ready? Because it's going to be crazy and it's going to be exciting. In Jesus' name. Awesome. I'm going to pray for some people. You good for time? Awesome. So good. So there are some people here and do you feel the stillness in here? Isn't it beautiful? So nice, isn't it? God's in such a good mood today. Do you know what his words are? Well done, good and faithful servant. This isn't a rebuke. It's an encouragement. It's an imploring. Paul often implored. I just want to encourage you. I feel like God is saying, "Are you ready?" And you know, sometimes if a runner is going to run, there's a process where God says or someone says, "You need to put on these running shoes right now because you're about to be put on the track." And there are some people here. You're about to be put on the track, and God's saying, "Do you want to have your shoes put on?" If you don't want them on, don't worry. But if you put them on, it's going to cost you something. And if you don't mind, I'd like to just share one very small testimony. I know I said that I'd finish. Please, you'll be okay. Let me just share you one more time. Before I went on to Crusades last year, and I don't know if I've ever shared this publicly, I had an experience where I was taken into a room in heaven, and I saw all of these crash helmets all lining the wall all of these crash helmets lining the wall. And I was in there, and I was on the outside, and there was a turnstile to go in, and I saw an evangelist by the name of Oral Roberts. And he stood up, and he came, and he stood at the entrance of the crash helmets. And I said, oh my goodness, what is this? And then I realized that each of the crash helmets had a name underneath it of an evangelist of the past. And I knew that each one had represented an evangelist that had gone and done crusades or tent meetings in the days of old. I think I can't remember the other people that I saw, but I saw other, not people, but the names in the place. And there was a helmet taken out. I've never shared this publicly, but a helmet taken out and presented to me on the other side of the turnstile. So on the other side, I said, what does that represent? And he said, this helmet represents the next level of protection that you need to go into crusade evangelism. And then the Lord took my wallet out of my pocket. And he said, you can't come in here with this wallet. I said, why? And he said, because if you come through, it's going to cost you everything. And what do you think I did? I went through. What does that mean? What do you mean it's going to cost you everything? Sometimes you think it's all about money. It's nothing to do with money. It's to do with you. Jesus says, if you lose your life for my sake, you will find it. How much are you holding on to your life? Because if you give it up, you will find it. And when you find it, it's more abundant and more blessed and more prosperous and more exciting than you could possibly imagine. And so I went through the turnstile and I said, I receive it. And that's when I got released to go and do stuff. And we started to do witch doctors. And we didn't do the witch doctors, but they were there. Why am I saying that? Because it was a necessary process. And I want to encourage you. I feel like today, I've said I'd pray for some people, but I feel like God is saying this today. I feel like today is an invitation. And I feel like Him saying, and we've got it, if you're a mum or dad, you're going to have to go and collect your kids in a second. But I want to leave you with this, and it's this. Today is an invitation to start to receive a new level, a next level of something that you're called to. And I feel like the Lord's saying, if you say yes, it's going to look like something. Do you want to say yes? So let's pray. Okay. So if that speaks to you, I'm going to ask you to just stand to your feet if you want that. If you don't, just stay seated because it's probably a dangerous prayer. Not everyone needs to stand up. Just stay seated if you want. It's so fine. And just say, Father, I want to receive something at a next level that will reconnect me or connect me to more of the destiny you have for me. I give you permission to eradicate fear. I give you permission to do anything in my heart that needs to be done in order that I would receive and be ushered into another thing that I'm called to do, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Awesome. It's good. Awesome. Listen, parents, you can go and grab your kids. Is it the right time to do it now? Yeah, go and grab your kids. But there is a Holy Spirit fire here right now. And I just want to, I don't know if we've got a team. Can we just have just keyboard or something. Yeah, that's fine. That's awesome. But I just want to, if you want to receive something right now in terms of just having an impartation of fire, I just want you to come forward. Parents, go and grab your kids first. But I want you guys to line up. I'm just going to lay hands on some people today. Probably be most people. And I'm going to get the guys that went to the camp as well, the nightlife guys, to lay hands as well, because there's an impartation in this place. And we'll do our best. We'll just touch you once. That's all. And then we'll pray for people. So nightlife guys, if you went to the camp, just start to release something. And I'd need a strong male. I need a catcher. So I need a good catcher. Who's a good catcher? I want to see him before I start. Roger. Okay, cool. Awesome. Come, whoever is fine. Thank you, Lord. Just relax.